I was asked to share some thoughts on perhaps some challenges or tensions or, I don't know, specificities of global education when we approach it from this part of the world, or this part of Europe, Central Europe, Central Eastern Europe. Certainly, I'm not going to talk for the whole region, but at least from the Polish perspective, I would like to share some thoughts. The issue of global education is for me not only a matter of teaching and research. I'm a sociologist and educator, but it's also a political issue for me, in a broad sense, perhaps in the sense that we sometimes associate with notions such as critical citizenship, for example. So the question I would like to start with would be, how do we view the global in the global education? How do we view the global from different perspectives, different parts of the world, and so on? And while certainly we know a lot about differences and about what's specific, when we use those strong terms in global education, such as North and South, and we know quite a lot about differences and what's specific, I have a feeling that we not so often problematize or think about how do we differ, or how we might differ, or how we differ, but not always recognize that within the northern part of the global here. For example, within Europe. So when I approach this, I'm thinking that older terminology no longer used that much these days, and it's about the first and the third world. Well, I come from the former second world, and we are the country that also belongs to the second world. So what happened? Where are we now? And how do we approach that? I think there are a number of challenges or tensions resulting from this problematization, or linked to this problematization, can be mentioned. And certainly one of the first ones that comes to mind, and it's not only the matter of education as such, but a broader political issue, is the question of development versus underdevelopment. I think there's something that we're still struggling with, so to speak, on both sides of the barricade here in Central and Eastern Europe. While we are now part of the club of the richest, the OECD, at the same time, we might say OECD is a lie. Well, we have the United States and Mexico in the OECD, so is Poland and Germany, for example. So this notion of semi-peripheral comes to mind, and perhaps would be interesting to consider. We have a state socialist past, but having a state socialist past not only means certain history, but it also brings us to the question, what happened after the collapse, what happened after 1989. So for instance, from the Polish perspective, I'm not sure how much that would be shared by others from this region of Europe, but from Polish perspective, to me, this post-socialist or post-communist past means quite a big embrace of neoliberalism in various ways. Not only that the transition was restoration of capitalism just to neoliberal, just on neoliberal tracks, but it's also that the political and economic elites of my country, they so eagerly promote now neoliberalism and have been promoted it for years throughout the European Union and further, and also to our eastern neighbors. There is a challenge, and when I'm thinking about this neoliberal embrace, when it comes to some questions about where, what would be our starting point for active citizenship, for example, when I was listening to you, Andy, and you're talking about community and engagement in community, and I realized that certain concepts work completely differently in this context. It's hard for me to think about community because of this neoliberal smash and individualism, and kind of a vacuum between an individual and this very abstract national community that strives towards nationalism. While there's, when we think about the civil society, there's something there, but perhaps our starting point would be different. I will return in a moment to the issue of nationalism, because I think that that's one of the big challenges too. I already mentioned the sense of dependency would be something. We are part of the club of the richest, and our countries have development policies oriented towards the poorer countries, but then again, just like US and Mexico, Poland and Germany would be an example of the two in the club of the richest, but different perspectives, and there is a sense throughout Polish society of this dependency, economic, political. Some even talk about cultural. I don't know about that. I'm not sure about that so much. Then another challenge is our internal tensions within the region. And what comes to my mind, and what is very much felt in Poland over the last 2 years or so, is the very big need for peace education. We're talking about global education, but peace education is certainly part of this. With the situation in Ukraine and growing, and in fact, persisting anti-Russian sentiment throughout Polish society, perhaps other societies too in the region, I think this is a very urgent need. Can we problematize it from the perspective of the global education? Is it part of this? Some other questions come to mind. Does global education have a class dimension? I'm thinking about this, for example, in the context of what we do, how we approach educationally a tension when, for example, certain environmental issues and social justice or social economic security issues are in immediate contradiction. For example, how do we approach with environmental issues like climate change, energy policy, and so on? How do we approach mining communities and children of mining families who are just struggling for keeping their jobs in coal mining sector? That's the case of Poland. The subject of refugees, this humanitarian and moral crisis that we now have in Europe, was also mentioned here today. And I just wanted to quote some results of a recent survey that was taken in Poland. Well, there's more or less 47% to 47% of general population sampled and polled for and against the reception of refugees from the Middle East and Africa in Poland. Among the young people, aged 18 to 24, 55% are against. Generally, but when it comes to specifically to people from Middle East or Africa, it's 60%. So it's more than half, almost two-thirds of young people are against. We have this challenge now in Poland. We're talking about active citizenship. Many people complain that people are apolitical, are not very active, but those who are usually those who are most attracted by right-wing populists. We have a challenge of xenophobia, we have a challenge of racism, we have a challenge of nationalism, which I think at least partially, but significantly, can be explained with this tension over semi-peripheral status. In the same poll, I'm about to finish, in the very same poll, actually only 13% of those polled said, those who are against the reception of refugees, said it was because of their cultural and religious otherness. But 44% said that the country has no resources and bad economic situation. Even if it's not very much true, and even if there are resources, that shows us something about state of mind of peoples, their awareness, and thus the challenge. So, while keeping in mind this possible specificity. There are certainly many commonalities. I would like to pose my question. I know that we were talking about several options for this question, but now I'm thinking, we are in this project Teachers, Agents of Change, but I would like us perhaps to reflect on, so what kind of change do we need? What kind of change do we want? Is it personal change in people? Political change of what kind? We are not party politicians, I guess, but still the political. And what kind of agency? What kind of agency for what kind of change? That would be my question. Thank you very much.